A very warm welcome to Facebook Live. And yes, it is a beautiful sunny day in Spain. Thank God for the sun. I think I'm going to do some cold water swimming today to get my spirits up. We are in a semi-lockdown situation, and that's why we are not meeting physically. The government has reduced it from 6 people being able to meet together to 4, and maybe, we were doing a comedy the other day, maybe it's 1. So you'll go to a restaurant and you'll see like 1 person at each table. But anyway, the government has encouraged us to really be respectful. There is an explosion of COVID cases in southern Spain at this time, and we don't want any WAVE member to get COVID. Unfortunately, there are a few of our WAVE family members who have tested positive. Melanie and I got our test the other day, and fortunately, we are negative. But a retreat, we're just retreating a little bit, doesn't imply that we're defeated. I believe that during this lockdown period, this time, that we're going to get stronger and stronger. And when this coronavirus ends, we're going to emerge stronger than ever before. Also, thank you so much for your generosity and giving. It's amazing that we've been kept afloat, you know, just by your obedience, by your generosity. And please, we just really encourage you to go to our website, puertovidnewschurch.com, and you can give online. Well, today I want to focus or talk about one of the most puzzling paradoxes, you could say, in our Christian walk, and that is, how can we be both sinner and saint at the same time? Wouldn't it just be great if we were just saints? In fact, that word saint, I think it occurs 67 times in the New Testament, and every time it's used, it refers to us. It doesn't refer to a special group of people that are holier than, you know, than us, than the other groups. Not like we're all Saint Teresa's, we're all canonized, we are all saints. And but yet we are all sinners at the same time, and therein lies the paradox. But if I said to you, hey Tom, or say if I was in a bar and I was introducing my friend Tom to some other friends of mine, I said, oh, by the way, this is Saint Tom. And then Tom immediately replies, hey, I'm no saint. But there's something in us that we're not comfortable with that word describing ourselves as saints, but yet we're very comfortable saying, well, hey, I'm a sinner saved by grace. But today, I really want to focus on the saint side in us, and not the sinner side in us. And it's really wonderful because you get Paul, okay, towards the end of his life, not the beginning of his life. He said this, I am the chief of all sinners. Okay? I mean, so hold on. Is Paul focusing on the fact that he's the chief of all sinners? Let's find out a little later. Or he says this in Romans 7, verse 18, I know that nothing good lives in me, that is, in my sinful nature. So Paul is saying, hey, I'm the chief of all sinners, and I have this sinful nature in me that nothing good happens. But then he also says, I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. For what I do is not good, the good I want to do. The evil I do not want to do, this I keep on doing. Do you have that fight in you? You know, you want to do something. I think during this lockdown period, it's amazing. I was talking to a friend, and this person said to me, you know what, I have a friend, and my friend has aged a lot during this lockdown period, meaning that he's in this turmoil. There's always that battle between saint and sinner, and sometimes in some people, it looks like the sinner, that evil nature, that dark nature where nothing good comes from it, is kind of dominating us and converting itself into this critical inner voice that just wants to pound us down, to bring us down and keep us in the cave. But now at the same time, Paul confesses this about himself, but then in Romans chapter 8, it's like he's a different person. Like there's like two different people. I mean, Romans 8 starts out like, therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. So Paul has just told us that he's the chief of all sinners. He has just told us that he wants to do good, but sometimes he feels blocked. He's just told us that he has this evil nature, that nothing good ever happens, confessing to that like critical inner voice that he has. Then suddenly he says, hold on, you know, the law of the Spirit has set me absolutely free. Then he goes on, and if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of the Spirit who lives in you. So I don't know if you can see this battle. I have this battle. I'm sure you have this battle. You know, you can't claim that you're without sin if you try to do that. It says in one of John's letters that we make him out to be a liar if we say that we're not a sinner. So we have these two people in us, the old man, the new man, the old woman, the new woman, and yes, they are doing battle. And many times I think we prefer to just blame everything on the devil, some outside, exterior type of, impersonal force way out there. The devil made me do it. No, many times we're our own worst enemies because we're focusing on, you know, the evil nature, the old man, the sinner, and not the saint in us. So I want to talk about what it means to focus on something. I use that word very specifically. I said, focus on the saint, not the sinner. I didn't say forget, you know, or pretend that you don't have, you know, the sinner side of you. I'm not saying that. Focus is, I think most of us, myself included, we approach life on this kind of automatic focus mode. You know, like if I have, pretend this little clock here is like a little camera, I just like point and click. But in the old fashioned days, you didn't point and you clicked, you know? I remember my dad taking pictures of me, and he took like 15 minutes just to focus his camera to get a good picture of his son. So what this means, like focus on something or focus on Jesus, the author and finisher of your faith. Literally, that's not going to come automatically. Sometimes focusing is just very difficult. And focusing is not forgetting, you know, the fact that you're a sinner or being delusional or for example, Melanie has a beautiful profile picture on her Facebook. And I see her lovely face, her hair, and it's just so sharp. It's so in focus. But everything around her is blurry. It's almost like it's in her peripheral vision. And, you know, her profile pictures focuses, in my opinion, on her beauty. But I can see other people around here, but they're all blurred. So this is what I mean. You know, Paul is not ignoring the fact, you know, that there's an evil nature in him. Okay, but he's learning how to live with it, learning how to manage it by focusing on the saint and not the sinner. Okay, so this is what I mean about focus. Now, I want to talk about three ways we can focus on the saint and not the sinner in us. Three ways we can successfully, okay, focus on the saint in us and not the sinner in us. Number one, focus on who we are in Christ and not who we are not. It's a profound statement because so many people come to us for counseling and literally they can talk to us for 5 hours, you know, about who they are not in Christ. 5 hours about the sinner, and they're comfortable and they're very familiar talking about who they are not or what they don't have or what they lack. But very few people spend 5 hours talking about who they are and what they have in Christ. Imagine how powerful that would be. That would really be a game changer for so many of us. Even the Bible says, think of things that are beautiful, that are good, that are excellent. Imagine if we thought and we forced ourselves, not automatic focus, you know, manual focus, to focus on who we are in Christ. Now, I love this. Paul writes to Timothy, and Timothy is a young man. He's having a hard time. He really is. His health is suffering, anxiety, fearful, timid. People are getting the upper hand at him from his own church. He feels persecuted. He's not in a good way. So, of course, Paul writes him a letter. And this is taken from 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 14 to 16. And it's from the Passion Version. Sometimes I just like to get some other translations here. And this is great. Absolutely, I think, very faithful to the Greek. It says, I was flooded, and this is Paul speaking, I was flooded with such incredible grace, like a river overflowing its banks, until I was full of faith and love for Jesus, the Anointed One. Wow, hallelujah to that. I can testify that the Word is true and deserves to be received by all. For Jesus Christ came into the world to bring sinners back to life. Even me, okay? The worst sinner of all. Yet I was captured by grace so that Jesus Christ could display through me the outpouring of his Spirit as a pattern, as an example, as an inspiration to be seen for all those who would believe in him for eternal life. Now, okay, remember I read that verse where Paul said, I am Saint Paul, Saint Paul, Saint Kurt, Saint Melanie, Saint you. Remember what Paul said? I am the chief. I am the worst of all sinners. But he wasn't focusing on that. Look, I mean, when you experience the grace of God, yes, it will bring out your sin, but you're not going to be focused on your sin. You're going to be focused on the gratitude, the grace. Paul was focused on that river of grace that flooded his heart and gave him love. That's what he was focused on, okay? Not the fact that, hey, I'm this miserable sinner. He said, yes, I am a sinner, but I am a sinner saved by this incredible river of grace, and I'm focusing on the river, you know, not the fact that I'm the worst of sinners. So Paul was focused more on the incredible grace overflowing its banks and not the sinner. So that's how I kind of can live with that Christian paradox of Kurt Kettner Burrow being sinner and saint at the same time. I'm a very, very grateful sinner. I'm very, very grateful to Jesus who flooded my life like that riverbank bursting. And I remember when I first came to know God, how marvelous, how wonderful it was. And sure, you're saying, whoa, thank you for saving me. Thank you for your grace. And that's what you focus on in that gratitude. It's healing. It will change your life. Number two, focus on what we have in Christ and not on what we don't have. And again, people come. I talk to so many Christians. Usually the conversation is what they lack, what they should have done, what they can do more of. I haven't been reading my Bible enough. Oh, I should be doing this. And nobody, very few people, are focusing on what they have. You know, in Peter writes to the church and he says, hold on, you've been given everything you need. You have everything already that you need, you know, for a life of life and godliness through his great promises. You have it. It's inside of you. You don't have to look out there. The Holy Spirit is inside of you. You can access it, you know, through his great and precious promises. But check this out. This is from the Amplified Bible. And we're looking at focusing on what we have in Christ as opposed to what we don't have in Christ. Or maybe you're in the lockdown and you're just saying, whoa, man, I've lost my job, I've lost this. And you get into that loss mode and then you take it over into your spiritual life and then your spiritual poverty in Christ. You're focusing more on your spiritual poverty than on the riches of Christ. But this verse from Ephesians chapter 3, verse 8, from the Amplified Bible. Sometimes things need to be amplified because the English language is limited in its expressive abilities. But it says this. This is Paul writing to the Ephesian church, and he says, to me, though I am the very least of all the saints. Okay, before he says he's the worst, the chief. Now he says, I'm the least of all the saints. Wouldn't that be refreshing, you know? Somebody gets up there and says, hey, I'd like to welcome 10,000 people to this conference. I just want to tell you that I'm the least. of all of you out there. But that's what Paul does. I find that very encouraging. To me, though I am the very least of all saints, this grace, this favor, this great privilege was granted and graciously entrusted to proclaim to the Gentiles the unending, boundless, fathomless, incalculable, and exhaustless riches of Christ, wealth which no human being could have ever searched out. So we have these incredible riches in Christ. For example, for me, joy is very important. I remember battling with depression for a large part of my life when I was growing up, before I was a believer. I had to be sent to psychiatrists, psychologists. I had to even be sent away from boarding school because I was just in such a bad situation. And when I looked like that, I kind of forget what I was saying. Okay, yeah. Oh yeah, so I'd focus actually on my depression, on the darkness in my life. I would never focus on what I had, what I could get excited about. So I want to say to you that focus on, oh yeah, here's what I was going to say. I have those like kind of senior moments sometimes, but I was going to say this. That guys, riches in Christ, what are they? For me, since I came out of a background where now I'm getting my track, where I suffered from depression, joy was very important for me. Do you know, people spend trillions of dollars around the world just to get joy. How much would you pay if God would come down and say, hey, I guarantee you 30% more joy if you pay this amount, okay? Fortunately, it's free. Fortunately, it comes with grace. So for me, I didn't have a lot of joy. That's why I talk about joy so much, because joy, it's like a currency to me. You know, joy is just so precious to God. So I focus on things that bring me joy, because joy is part of the arsenal of the riches of Christ. It could be peace. Focus on peace. It could be forgiveness. Focus on forgiveness. These are the riches. This is the storehouse of our riches in Christ. So let's draw from those riches. Let's focus on those riches. Number three. Focus on who we are becoming in Christ and not on who we are not becoming. Wow. Man, I can sit down with people and they can tell me about their undoing. They can tell me about their struggles. And of course, we show empathy. You know, I've been there. I remember going through a period like a year and a half where I was more focused on my undoing, on my unbecoming, rather on who I was becoming. And no matter what I did, I just couldn't break out of that kind of mode of darkness. It was absolutely terrible. It was hard to focus. It's not like I even had the desire. I had this kind of darkness of self-pity, and taking out that camera and taking the time to focus on something was very difficult, but it had to be done. And sometimes it really costs me, but by the grace of God, I managed to focus. Often I lost my focus, but it's just so, don't feel discouraged if you can't focus. Just take out that camera, focus on something beautiful. Focus on something positive that is happening in your life. Don't focus on your undoing and feel bad about yourself, but focus on who you are becoming. I love this. I guess I could call this the ugly duckling syndrome. That would be a good name for it. So instead of saying focus on the saint, not the sinner, I could say focus on the swan and not the ugly duckling. We all have a beautiful swan in us, but unfortunately we have an ugly duckling. No offense against ducklings. I love them. But this is called like the ugly duckling syndrome, where we're more focused on the ugly duckling, criticizing, listening to the critical inner voice, rather than focusing on what we can become the beautiful swan. And I love this by Hans Christian Andersen. I've read it before, the story of the ugly duckling, and it begins on a beautiful summer day in Denmark, just like we have a beautiful sunny day today, and it introduces us to the ugly duckling and his just his life of rejection. You know, I remember he was like almost frozen to death. A farmer saves him, and then there's like two little animals at the farmer's house, and the cat says, "Look, I can purr. You know, what can you do?" The chicken says, "Look, I can lay an egg, but what can you do?" So the ugly duckling escapes, isolates, moves away from all community, and he's just kind of waddling down the road, and he sees this lake. And in the middle of the lake, there's some beautiful swans, absolutely beautiful. And he's focusing, saying, "You know what? If only I could become something like that. If only I could be like one of those beautiful birds out there in the middle of the lake." And then it says, we're going to pick up the story. And I always kind of tear up when I read this. I don't know why, but I do. And it says this: "Then he flew to the water and swam towards the beautiful swans. The moment they espied the stranger, they rushed to meet him with outstretched wings. 'Kill me, kill me,' said the poor little ugly duckling. And he bent his head down to the surface of the water and awaited death. But what did he see in the clear stream below? His own image. No longer a dark gray bird, ugly and disagreeable to look at, but a graceful and beautiful swan. He now felt glad at having suffered sorrow and trouble, because it enabled him to enjoy so much better all the pleasure and happiness around him. For the great swans swam around the newcomer and stroked his neck with their beaks as a welcome." Tearing up. "Into the garden presently came some little children," some little Danish children, "and threw bread and cake into the water. 'See,' cried the youngest, 'there is a new swan, a new one.' And the rest were delighted and ran to their father and mother, dancing and clapping their hands and shouting joyously, 'There is another swan. Come on, a new swan has arrived.' Then they threw more bread and cake into the water and said, 'The new one is the most beautiful of all. He is so young and pretty.' And the old swans bowed their heads before him. Then he felt quite ashamed and hid his head under his wing, for he did not know what to do. He was so happy and yet not at all proud. He had been persecuted and despised for his ugliness." This is what we do to ourselves. "And now he heard them say he was the most beautiful of all birds." You know, it's like, am I a saint? Am I a sinner? Am I a swan? And an ugly duckling. "Even the elder tree bent down its boughs into the water before him, and the sun shone warm and bright. Then he rustled his feathers, curved his slender neck, and cried joyfully from the depths of his heart, 'I never dreamed of such happiness as this while I was an ugly duckling.'" So many of us, we focus on the ugly duckling, not on the swan. So many of us, we focus on the sinner and not the saint. So many of us, we focus on the darkness and not the light. So many of us, we focus on the rumors and the lies rather than the truth that can set us free. And I want to leave you with just two very brief scriptures that have changed my life, the way I do life, and can help us if we're suffering from that kind of what we call the saint-sinner syndrome. And possible, John says in 1 John chapter 3, verse 2, "Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is." That young, ugly duckling, he said, the years of suffering and persecution, it was all worth it, because I found out who I was. And the Bible says, you know, that Christ endured everything. You know, we have a high priest who is able to empathize, feel, be with us in our time of weakness and our humanity. So if you're feeling you don't have it together, that perhaps you're that ugly duckling, you know, let Jesus minister into your life and you will become that swan. You will be like Jesus yourself. How about what Paul says in Romans 8:18? "I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. Do you know that the Apostle Paul doesn't talk that much about heaven? I mean, in our culture, everybody says, oh, when I go to heaven, it's going to be so beautiful. Paul reverses the equation when he says, when I get to heaven, heaven's going to be in me. The amazing things are going to be in me. This is what he says. He says, I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. Not the glory that will be revealed for us in heaven, but the glory that will be revealed in us. Now, I live for that glory. Man, if you're going through a hard time during this lockdown, look, this lockdown, this coronavirus, we're in the worst of times. We're in the worst of times, but we're also in the best of times to work on ourselves, to make sure that the saint in us wins over the sinner, to make sure that the light in us wins over the darkness, to make sure that the ugly duckling gets left behind and our swan nature embraced. I want to encourage you, all of us, during this time of just global upheaval. It's the worst of times, but yet I pray that it would be the best of times for us. So the 3 points. Number one, focus on who you are in Christ rather than who you are not in Christ. Number two, focus on what you have in Christ, okay, rather than what you do not have. And finally, number four, focus. Number three, focus on who you are becoming, not on who you are not becoming, not on your undoing. Focus on the saint and not the sinner. Focus on the new creation rather than the old creation in you. Focus on the new man, the new woman, the new person in you rather than the old person in you. And then your life will dramatically change. God bless you. Father God, I thank you so much. I mean, I'm even encouraged, like kind of preaching this message to myself. I think part of our problem is we listen too much to our feelings, to the critical inner voice, and we don't speak to ourselves enough. And Lord, we speak to ourselves today. Your word, your truth, what you think of us, that you died for us. And Lord, if there's any one of you that does not know Jesus today, wow, it's so simple. Just say, Jesus, I want to begin my adventure with you. I want to get to know you. I repent from my sins and I embrace what you're doing. He'll give you his precious Holy Spirit. He'll empower you. You might not feel like you can do anything, but give him a chance. And he works in our weaknesses. That's the beautiful thing. In our ugliness, in our darkness, that's where he longs to display his glory. And you will become, metaphorically speaking, that beautiful swan. God bless you, and we will see you soon.